We're here at Pikes Peak International Hill Climb on the setup day, and I've just grabbed James from Honda RnD to get a little bit of detail about the Acura TLX A-Spec that's sitting behind us. It's running in the exhibition class tomorrow at Pikes Peak. Now, James, this isn't a car that we get back home in New Zealand, so it's running a 3.5-litre J-Series engine, is that correct?
Yeah, that's correct.
Now, naturally aspirated, that probably wasn't going to cut it. So one of the first things I see is you've gone and fitted quite a large turbo. Can you tell us what that turbo is?
So that turbo is a BorgWarner EFR turbo. It's based on the T4. It is honestly a little bit large for the car if you were to drive us around at sea level. But it actually is quite advantageous here for the high altitude where we're going to be competing.
I just want to touch on that with the high altitude. So I think it's lost on a lot of people. If we want to run a certain amount of inlet manifold pressure, let's say, for example, 20 psi, that 20 psi down at sea level is completely different for the turbocharger than if we're going to run 20 psi at the peak at the summit here at 14,000 feet. So can you just explain why that larger turbo actually gives us an advantage for a large altitude change such as Pikes Peak?
Well, yeah, the biggest item here is if you want to maintain power, as you're mentioning here with the altitude change, as we're losing the ambient pressure, we have to increase the pressure that the turbo is outputting to keep that consistent inlet manifold pressure. So with a larger turbo, we have a lot more bandwidth on the compressor map to run at higher pressure ratios at that given mass airflow. So for us, that's the only way we're able to do it. Otherwise, you have to actually derate the engine as you're going up the hill, or you'll overspeed the turbocharger.
So I'll just touch on that. You mentioned the term pressure ratio, and what that is the outlet pressure from the turbocharger divided by the inlet pressure, which is typically pretty close to barometric air pressure. So that's why for a given manifold pressure, that pressure ratio continually climbs as the altitude and altitude increases, barometric air pressure drops. Now, the other interesting thing there is the engine management that you're using on the car. In a lot of places, a lot of people for this sort of competition would choose to go straight for an aftermarket ECU, and you've stayed with the factory, the OE ECU. Can you tell us about that, or why you've made that choice?
Well, I suppose it's a little bit unfortunate or unfair because I work for Honda R&D, actually most of our team does. By virtue of that, we actually have access to all of the factory software and calibrations. So it's a little bit unfair and doesn't really relate very well to the aftermarket, but I mean, some of the techniques that we're utilizing are in essence the same thing you'd use.
So with this, basically you've got complete backdoor access to the original Honda ECU. You're able to manipulate and tune that exactly the same way the calibration engineers at Honda and the factory did on the factory car in the first place?
That's correct. Actually, my day job at Honda R&D is the calibration of the J-Series engine for use in North America. So again, for us, it's a little bit unfair that we have that advantage. But the key item to talk about here is that the J-Series engine is a wonderful tuner's engine. By virtue of the fact that it is a fixed cam engine, it removes a lot of the complexity out of going to a turbocharged setup. You're vastly increasing the manifold pressure and the amount of power you're making, but it's very easy then to kind of linearly change your ignition maps and to change your fueling maps without a lot of difficulty. And the biggest item here too is it's got a mass airflow sensor, so you're not having to deal with speed density.
Let's just talk about that, because that is really a big aspect. Most of the aftermarket ECUs are running speed density, mass airflow sensors taken, thrown away, and all of the ECUs' calculations on mass airflow are done based on a manifold absolute pressure sensor. And I think in the aftermarket, in a lot of ways, the mass airflow sensor is probably undervalued, and when set up correctly, it's actually a really great tool. But can you just tell us a little bit about how that mass airflow sensor actually can be an advantage when we're dealing with large barrow changes like at Pikes Peak?
Well, I mean, the biggest item here is, as you mentioned, we're dealing with very large barometric changes. We're having a difficulty in actually accurately representing how much air the engine is breathing. By using a mass airflow sensor, as long as we understand the diameter of the pipe and the reference temperature in that pipe, we can easily always know the actual mass of air that's coming into the inlet to the turbocharger. And in our case, we're not even changing the sensor for mass production. All we're doing is changing the pipe's diameter, which of course then would require us to change the calibration to match that larger diameter. But it's a simple table, and you're ready to run. So,
So let's just come back to that one step. So essentially, for those who aren't really familiar with the two technologies, with a mass airflow sensor, we've got the advantage. We are directly measuring the mass of air entering the engine. That's one of the key inputs that the ECU really needs to know in order to calculate fuel and also ignition advanced requirements. Whereas with the speed density system that's favoured in the aftermarket, all of that mass airflow data is kind of calculated. So there's the ability for some error to creep in there. Now, it's great that you just touched on the size of the mass airflow sensor, or the calibration. So it's as easy, obviously the original intake system was never designed for the sort of power you're making now, so it's as easy as just refitting that same factory sensor into a larger diameter tube. Is there any downsides to doing that?
Well, one of the major ones that you have to consider is that by changing the diameter of that pipe, the sensor is going to run a lot closer to its minimum accuracy limit. So it's going to be at a very, very low voltage or reference mass air flow. And if you don't change your idle speed of the vehicle, you're going to start to run into some trouble, especially at these higher altitudes. So in the particular case of this car, we've bumped up the idle speed to 1200 or 1300 RPM, which is almost double factory. But that then allows us to operate the mass airflow sensor in its more accurate range.
So for a street car, that might be perhaps a slight disadvantage, but in a race application, no problem.
No problem at all, yeah.
I just want to go back a little bit to the turbocharger. Now, I think speaking to one of the technicians before, it's a BorgWarner EFR 8374 fitted to the car. As you mentioned, probably maybe a little bit bigger than you'd typically fit to this engine if you were trying to make 500 horsepower. Now, I just want to get some information on what you're doing with the boost pressure as the car climbs the mountain to maintain a constant actual engine power.
So with our specific car, what we're doing is we're actually increasing the boost pressure, the target boost pressure, as we go up the hill. And by doing that, obviously we're having to keep the wastegate closed more and more and more. But for us, the key item is safety, to not overspeed the turbo. And it's one of those things that, of course, you can buy the EFR now with a direct speed sensor on the compressor wheel. In our case, we didn't need to do that because we can actually calculate the turbo speed just based on the pressure pre and post turbocharger, and understanding what the airflow meter is reading for mass, we're able to actually calculate where the turbo speed is. And so basically we're raising the turbo's boost pressure as we drive up the hill, but keeping it below that maximum speed line.
Right, so that's just taking that data essentially. You've talked about the pressure ratio there. That's one axis of the turbocharger's compressor map, and then the mass airflow is the other axis. So you've got all of that information. You're measuring the barometric pressure, the outlet pressure from the turbocharger, and of course with the accurately calibrated mass airflow sensor, you've got the mass flow, so that's why you can pinpoint exactly what that critical turbocharger speed is. Now, just one other aspect I wanted to ask about is when the car comes back from a practice run here at Pikes Peak, what are the key elements that you're looking for in the data in order to make changes for the next run, maybe improve the performance of the car, or at least validate that it's doing everything you wanted it to do?
The biggest item that we're always checking, of course, is what has been the learned value for the fueling. So I mentioned before, this car comes from the factory, I think, with wideband air-fuel ratio sensors, and we're utilizing those in a feedback loop constantly, even when we're at high boost. The accuracy of the sensor does suffer a bit in a highly enriched state, but we at least look at that data to see, are we accurately measuring or monitoring the amount of air going in, and is it coming back as a reasonable value on the airflow sensor, or sorry, the air-fuel ratio sensor. So that's generally when it comes back, we're checking temperatures. Is the engine running hot? Are we getting decent intake air temperatures? Are we having any knock? And then are we keeping our air-fuel ratios in check?
Just coming back to that, it's interesting because we've just discussed the fact you've fitted that mass airflow sensor into a larger diameter pipe, requiring that it is recalibrated. So what is the process you're actually going through for that calibration? Is it based on those fuel trims, how close those fuel trims are to zero, or are you a little bit more involved than that with actually flow benching the airflow meter?
Well, it can be done, I guess, a couple of different ways, and you basically touched on both of them. You can do it by doing a rough ratio from the original mass airflow sensor's diameter pipe to your large one. You can kind of scale your table, and that's how we start. And then, yes, we just go and check by actual readings. How far off are we on our air-fuel ratio trims? So, yeah, it's fairly straightforward.
Look, that's been really interesting, James. Thank you for giving us some insight into the car, and we wish you guys all the best of luck for Sunday.
Great. Thanks very much. I really appreciate it.